Response has been exceptional this year, with 40 gifts being committed to be purchased, and I understand that's an increase of 10, so what's that, 20%? Something like that. So thanks for all of your caring generosity, and shortly Pat Randazzo will be receiving the names of the recipients to be matched to the donors, and those who have agreed to be part of this project will receive further instructions at that time. Later this morning, we will be celebrating the Sacrament of Holy Communion. You have your bags. For many of you, this is your second time around, so I'm hoping it will be a little bit easier to open the packages. But you'll remember that there's a tiny thin flap at the top when it comes to the time to do this. And inside is a wafer, and then there's a second thicker flap which opens the grape juice for you. You'll obviously notice that we have our new sound system in place, and we are there may be a few glitches along the way as we learn how to use it appropriately, but it will allow us to do things. We also have internet access here too now, which will allow us to do much more easily things that, as you saw this morning with Louis Armstrong, but it will also allow us to do live streaming, and that's really important, so that people can actually, who cannot come or choose not to come in this time of COVID, will be able to join us at the same time. Or they can still watch it later on. So I want to make sure, is everyone hearing me okay on the mic? Okay, good. Is it? That's just me, maybe. I don't know. All right, and I want to give thanks to all those who were involved long before I was here, I think, in planning to have this new sound system, and for those who operate the system who came for a special training session and will come again for another training session to do with the live streaming. And I want to thank Pacific Audio Works for installing this for us and getting us trained. So now I would invite you to, if you have any other announcements or celebrations, birthdays, bear in mind though that we did this last week, we cannot sing happy birthday. We have to let Amy be our representative singer. We can sing from our hearts and or hum very quietly into our masks. So, do we have any other announcements, celebrations to uplift at this time?
Well, I just want to remind everyone that I have Sunday school organized today. table, masks, and that sort of thing. But if any children ask, say, yes, we do have Sunday school available. Okay?
Nobody has anything fantastic to announce. Chris?
I'll announce that we had 140 children last night on our street.
Oh, wow.
It was all manner of contraptions for sliding the food to the kids, including mine, that was very proud of. I picked up my truck. And so Halloween did happen.
Yeah.
That's great. Well, I think most of you heard my announcement, but that's a real celebration in that my grandson was born on October 27th and is doing fine, a little premature, 4 pounds, 2 ounces, but is doing excellently and should be getting home hopefully within the next few days. So, and mommy's fine too. Can't forget my daughter. So that's great. Great news. Any other announcements? No. Well, we've come with joy into one another's presence, and now let us also come with joy as we come further into God's holy presence. May the light of this candle remind us of the fire that warms our hearts, the love that we are called to share, and the light that guides our way.
Today's opening hymn is at Voices United 342. I think it might be a new hymn for us.
Those who have gone before us, who were transformed by your power.
Your spirit gave wisdom to the humble,
eloquence to the halting of speech, courage to the fearful, bright hope to those in prison.
Present God, we long for strength and renewal. We yearn to be the church that is the living body of Christ for the world.
Fill us with your Spirit's power.
Future God, give us grace to trust your promises and offer our faithfulness.
Knowing that you are always at work, seeking, saving, healing, transforming.
Bless us in this time of worship by your life-giving presence.
We pray in the name of Christ our Savior.
For all the saints who from their labors rest, you who by faith before the world confessed your name, O Jesus, be forever blessed. Alleluia.
Welcome, Helen Wright, to read scripture for us today.
Let us pray. gracious God, we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. Make us hungry for this heavenly food, that it may nourish us today in ways of eternal life, through Jesus Christ, the bread of heaven. Amen. The book of Revelation is challenging for many Christians for several reasons. The book addresses a historical situation foreign to most North American readers, a dire situation of severe political oppression and martyrdom. Also, the book is replete with apocalyptic images of the end time, images that are violent, frightening, and disorienting. And yet this book, when read and interpreted appropriately, offers words of profound hope and encouragement for followers of Christ to work for a better world. We read from Revelations chapter 7, verses 9 to 17. After this, I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the glory, before the throne, and worshiped God, saying, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship God day and night within this temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd and will guide them to springs of water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." The Gospel reading is known as the Beatitudes from Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. In this passage, Jesus describes the nature of God's realm and the character of citizenship in that realm. It's important to note that the Beatitudes do not use the imperative, but the indicative. That is, they are not meant to be moral injunctions, but simple facts reflecting how things work for us as a people of faith who trust in God. So we read from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 5, verse 1 to 12. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Here are the readings from the Holy Scripture. For these words and insights, we give God thanks and praise. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. The origin of All Saints Day cannot be traced with certainty, but that day has been observed different dates of the year and different places as early as the 4th century AD. All Saints Day arose from the early Christian tradition of celebrating the martyrdom of those who were killed because of their belief in Christ, and as such were declared to be saints. Today, in many churches, we not only honor those who were martyred, but recognize and celebrate saintliness, utilizing a more comprehensive understanding of what it means to be a saint. So I'd like to explore this with you a little bit this morning, in conjunction with the readings that Colin just provided for us, and in particular, the book of Revelation. Although many Christians shy away from the book of Revelation, the apocalyptic vision of the enigmatic John of Patmos helps to envision for us what saints might actually look like. At first glance, the imagery is strange and otherworldly. We're told that angels are gathered around a throne with four living creatures falling on their faces, worshiping God day and night, singing songs of praise. And we're told that those robed in white will hunger and thirst no more, and that sun and heat will not strike them because the Lamb is their shepherd, guiding them to springs of the water of life as God wipes every tear from their eyes. A very familiar passage from funeral and memorial services. As idyllic and glorious as the image may seem, it is incomplete. John's description doesn't stop there. He goes on to write that the great multitude gathered around the throne are those who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. While the language is, to our ears, strange, perhaps even offensive, in John's vision, those who enjoy the place of honor have undergone suffering. And given the tone of such apocalyptic literature in general, Revelation in particular, we can surmise that these ones robed in white have suffered from horrific violence, tortured and murdered because of their faith. So what do we do today, in this place and time, with this otherworldly language and these strange wild images that the writer of Revelation sets out for the reader? And the quick answer is to do as others have done, and I have done from time to time, simply reshelve the book of Revelation. It's an indecipherable apocalyptic dream sequence by an unknown, perhaps out of his mind, disciple of the fledgling first century Jesus movement. But as I think upon it, as wars rage on and threats of even nuclear war haunt our days, as violent acts daily bombard our TV screens, as diseases, even a worldwide pandemic, and disasters and tragedies of all sorts continue to strike with indiscriminate and unrelenting cruelty, as the unreliability and injustice of the global economy continue to provoke fear and anxiety, we may know more than we think we do about these great ordeals and blood-stained robes that John identifies so provocative. And on this day especially, the Spirit is calling the church to reconsider John's apocalyptic witness, complete with all its harsh images and violent scenes. As otherworldly as this biblical book seems to be with its, for us, bizarre, weird imagery, it is in actuality very down to earth in its purpose and its meaning. Marvin Ellison, scholar, biblical scholar, in his study of Revelation, describes this book as offering a forceful theological critique of empire, issuing an urgent warning to follow the way of God rather than becoming complicit in an unjust world order. While the Pax Romana, that's the peace of Rome, proclaims the Roman Emperor as the source of all prosperity, health, safety, and peace, the book of Revelation attributes people's well-being and their very lives to God alone. The writer of Revelation declares to us that salvation belongs not to the Caesars of the world, but to our God who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb who is Christ. according to Revelation's theopolitical imagination, all other imperial claimants, including Caesar and the contemporary counterparts of Caesar in our own world, have been dethroned, or if not dethroned, at least spiritually defeated. The book of Revelation inspires hope for a better world. It's interesting how different denominations have come to terms with that particular book. In Christian circles, this question sometimes arises, and it's on opposite sides of the spectrum related to that book. Does salvation belong to this world or to another? To a heavenly realm far beyond this troubled, sometimes wicked world? Is heaven to be on earth, as we say in the Lord's Prayer, or is salvation about escape from this life, from this world? Among marginalized communities and other worldly spirituality has sustained hope for many whose lives are so miserable they can only imagine release and salvation in the hereafter, or for future generations by God's intervention. But among the powerful and privileged, this otherworldly spirituality has functioned very differently by legitimizing the status quo, allowing the saints to opt out of responsibility for care of the earth and care for other people, and by promising pie in the sky, delayed compensation, and rich rewards for suffering endured in this life, pointing towards heaven and getting away from the problems of earth. Our saints, those who are devoted believers, committed to a personal relationship with their Lord, keeping their eyes on a heavenly prize, or are they those who are involved in the world, actively resisting evil and injustice? Let me suggest that the book of Revelation, like much of the Gospels that depict the teachings and way of Jesus, declares that the saints are those who oppose empire, oppose those persons or groups or nations with power that oppress, dominate, often violently, ordinary women, men, and children for self-centered gain. In the midst of the violent imagery and occluded visions lies this profound word of hope and encouragement. Revelation tells us that after all is said and done, after the plagues of war and famine and disaster and disease have done their worst, salvation comes not from the dictators and the power brokers and the warmongers of this world, or even from what we call fate or luck. No, salvation, true life, meaningful and purposeful, eternal life comes from God alone. This is a great and enduring truth of the faith. And it comes alive on this All Saints Day, reminding the faithful that the powers and principalities of the world will not have the last word. This reversal of the customs of the world is found as well in our gospel reading today, when Jesus proclaims these beatitudes, these blessings. There's a paraphrase I'd like to share with you. I just like it, not. But it's interesting how you can take those particular blessings and interpret them for your own lives. Unsure of your direction in life, you're blessed. Caught under the weight of grief and loss, joy comes in the morning. Undervalued and not heard by those around you, God hears you. Groaning with hunger pains and longing for a moment of respite, the Comforter has come. Sojourning for peace and righteousness, only to be trampled down by war and revilement and those spreading lies to discredit you, God is traveling along right beside you. The saints, Jesus reminds us, aren't simply those who seem to have it all figured out, whose prayer life is perfect, whose service to the church and community alike are irreproachable, and who have left a legacy that the rest of us will only ever aspire to for all our lives. On the contrary, the saints, Jesus tells us and John reminds us, are those who have suffered greatly, and some who suffer still in our midst, and yet praise God all the more. The saints are those who have known the pain of grief and the sting of death, and still manage to find a way to sing, Hallelujah. And the song of the saints may not always come in lovely four-part harmony, but the saints always make a joyful noise. Even in the midst of war, social upheaval, famine, pandemic, saints cannot keep from singing, even if it's just from their hearts or a gentle humming into Mass. Yes, the saints are those who make joyful noise. And they are also those who carefully listen to the good news of Jesus Christ. Living between the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, saints hear the raucously good news of God's final future word reaching back into history. Back to where they live and breathe and have their being. They make a joyful noise of God's final victory, anticipating it, participating in it, in their present circumstances, whatever those might be. They make a joyful noise for courage to live in the present while always facing the future with hope. Saints from every nation make a joyful noise, keeping hope alive in our world. Worship on Sunday, the first day of the week, is considered to be representative of Easter. Each Sunday when we worship is a reminder of the resurrection, that glorious sign of victory, of ultimate triumph, of good over evil, of life over death. Just as the white robe is the martyr's sign of courage and faithfulness. Perhaps that is why the singing of the hymns and anthems is so important in worship, and why we miss singing so much our hymns during this COVID-19 crisis, as much as we enjoy hearing Amy's singing for us. We yearn to sing. We yearn to sing, to make a joyful noise, because no matter what life throws at us, no matter what the world's up to, the saints, that's all of you, keep singing. Keep making a joyful noise. And in doing that, continue to proclaim the good news to one another and to the world. Our worship on this day bears both the potential for difficult, despairing news, the bad news that is hard to hear, as well as the uplifting, hope-filled news, the good news that continually confounds even our best efforts to contain. For if we approach this day looking to the saints as solely those long-gone exemplars of moral perfection and unwavering faith, then the witness of Jesus in Matthew's Gospel and of John's Revelation falls flat and bears little possibility for transformation for the rest of us. But if we take in the Spirit of God in our midst, might be surprised by what we see when we look across the aisle of the church, or down the street, or even into the parts of our neighborhoods that have a checkered reputation. We might be surprised to find there saints. Saints who, even in the midst of unimaginable circumstances, find ways to lift up their hearts in prayer and to praise God, and who are determined to live as best they can the way of Jesus. So today, as I conclude, I want you to preface your name with the word saint. Think of your first name and then put saint in front of it. Saint Helen. I think there are three Saint Helens here today. Saint Simon. Saint Nancy. Saint Bill. Saint Lisa. Saint Bruce. Saint Marion. Saint Roberta. Saint Marlene. Saint Pat. Saint Joy. Saint Frida. Saint Renee. St. Stephen, St. Amy.
St. Bob.
And if I missed anyone, you are a saint too.
St. Bruce.
I did. And when we hear those soft but faithful notes of Alleluia emanating from deep within our souls, the souls of the saints, we will know that salvation does indeed belong to our God, who is seated upon the throne now and forevermore. Thanks and praise be to God.